I would love one of those flying cars. I just will not let my neighbor take off from their backyard with it. But I want to talk to you about this marriage of computers and cars, which is going to be astounding and change one of the world's biggest industries and many other industries beyond it. Now, there are several pillars of change that we will see, but the most important is not a financial one. The reason most people got into this was, in fact, the ability to save lives is so important, and that's because we human beings are not very good drivers. Every year around the world, we're killing 1.2 million people. This is like one of the world's major diseases. It is an astonishing figure. Now, in the United States, it was about 36,000 people last year who were killed in car accidents, with a cost of about $870 billion. That works out to 29 cents a mile or 16 euro cents a kilometer, more than the cost of the benzene to drive. You spend more for your share of accidents than you do for the fuel. And in addition to this, I calculated Americans spend every year 50 billion hours doing this. 50 billion hours manipulating steering wheels. The entire productive labor output of the United States is about 240 billion hours a year. That's how much time is going into driving. Now, over here, the number sounds a lot better, only 479 deaths, but that's about 80% of the number of the United States per kilometer, so better, but not much better. Europeans tend to drive a little better. However, if you want to die in a European car crash, there is one city you can go to with reasonable success. So, 40% of those fatalities involve alcohol, and there's another good thing because robots very rarely drink, this famous Mexican robot being a counterexample. We've also given over our cities and our economies to cars in ways we've become blind to. Over 25% of the energy budget of big economies and the CO2 output comes from driving, and the entire human race, I calculated, spends about 1.7 light years driving every year. How many of you use light years in your work as a unit of human activity? It's remarkable to think about it.
We want to establish and build a new means of transportation.
Although you're working on it every day, you still got these moments where you think, wow, that is something really, really cool that we're doing here, and it just feels amazing to be actually a really big part of that.
An airplane that takes off vertically, like a helicopter. But once it's in the air, it accelerates into forward flight and flies with wing-borne lift. And this way it achieves much higher speeds than cars, but also higher speeds than a helicopter. So connectivity is what it's all about.
By BMW at the Consumer Electronics Show. And if you look in the back left of this concept car, there's a bookshelf there. This is a company that for 100 years has sold Freude am Fahren, right? That's their slogan. And yet here they are thinking of the car as a living room. That's how radically differently they have to think. Ford has even gone so far as to say that their vehicle, this is its prototype, will not be available to customers. They will only sell it for use in taxi fleets. You will not be able to buy it as an individual. And there is another German automaker, actually, which may have a problem in telling people, trust your life to our software. After all, why would we lie to you? No. To be fair, actually, to their benefit, that scandal is making them rethink their entire company. It may actually turn out to be positive in the long run for them as well as for others. This vehicle from the high-tech nation of France has actually been for sale for over 3 years. And it's out running around on corporate campuses. It doesn't go very fast. It doesn't go on the main streets, and thus it's been able to actually be not a prototype or a concept, but a product that's been for sale and is in campuses today. Now, there is other activity in Europe. This vehicle is running around in the Netherlands, and in fact, last year, all the transport ministers in Europe got together for the Declaration of Amsterdam, and they vowed to change all the European road laws to allow this technology to happen. The Chinese are in this game as well. For some reason, search engines are very big, so this is Baidu's vehicle, and China is now the world's number one car manufacturing country. People may not know that it's exceeded Europe and the United States in terms of manufacturing cars.
Then because we have to go from A to B.
Exactly. They're fundamental changes, and AI is at the center of it all. So I would have to say that.
So, I mean, time is running out. Last question.
Yep.
Are you a contrarian? Do you believe in something that others don't believe in?
It's a good question. I guess that probably would be AI as well. People in the popular imagination really think that walking, talking robots that are just like humans, who are sentient, are around the corner. That's way, way out, right? So the kind of AI that people imagine is happening soon, it's not going to be that way. And there'll be some element of that, but it will be quite a lot further out. There are a lot of academic challenges we need to solve, and companies like DeepMind are doing a great job, now they're owned by Google, at that, but it's not going to be in 5 years, 10 years, 20 years time even, right? True AI, where we have sentient computers, or if you want to call it that, that's not just around the corner.
Yeah, someone
even,
once
even if the movies make
someone it. Someone in AI once told me that when I asked him the question, he said, yes, I'm also worried about overpopulation on Mars.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
All right, all the questions that you've put on Slido, we will ask Siraj to answer them, and we will put up a blog post with the answers. I think that's about it, right?
Well, actually, we have time for just a couple questions from Slido, if that's all right. So,
let's do it.
Some of you guys already remember from last year, we used a technology called Slido. So, if you take a look up there, you can go to slido.com, you can ask your questions, and then we'll pick a few and we'll ask them of our guests here. So, the first one is, we'd like to ask, what is the best way to get in touch with Atomico to collaborate?
We try to be pretty open and approachable. So, usually, first we'll invest Series A and beyond, not super early. So, to approach us via your seed investors is probably the most reliable. But people should also feel free to email me or, any of the other partners.
I would like to add a question. Be honest, how fast are you in putting the black on the white and the green in the bank? How long does the DD take at Atomico?
It depends on the stage of the company. The later the stage, the longer it takes, but that's totally fine. But for a later stage company, it could be 4 weeks. Green in the bank might be a little bit later, because there's usually a DD process afterwards that is really about legals and that kind of stuff, can take another 4 to 6 weeks. That's for later stage. For earlier stage, it can be, in a week or so, within a week.
Hi guys, as you know, we're here at Pioneers Festival, and we're here at the Speakers Lounge, and I came across Till Hunschild. I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly, am I?
Well, almost. Hauschild.
Oh, Hauschild, I love that. Now tell me, you are from GoGuard. What does GoGuard do?
So that's my newest company. It's a private safety app.
Uh-huh.
So you put your emergency contacts in the app.
Yes.
And then if you're in a situation that isn't that secure, like walking through a dark park or something, you can activate the app. It streams the GPS and audio, and if you like, video stream to our servers and to your emergency contacts.
Oh.
So if you hit
I love it. So tell me, how did you start GoGuard?
So the basic idea, or one of our co-founders, he worked in the security sector for a while, and his daughter got mugged in the park, and he said, she always carries the phone around and uses it, but that didn't help in that situation. And so he came up with the idea to create that. And
So a personal experience. This is often how things happen, and then you get a concept. And it's true, it's safety is so paramount, especially for the young and college kids as well. So it comes from personal experience. Tell me, how did you get involved in this?
So the funny thing is that another co-founder, he invested in a company I did before. So we know each other and...
You've worked together before, I like
it. Yeah, so as an investor startup. And then I'm the rapid prototyping guy, so I'm able to do everything from development to final product.
Oh, you see it from idea to completion to execution.
Yeah. So they had the idea and the connections and the money, and I got the execution.
Oh, fantastic. So tell me, how long have you been in this whole startup entrepreneur space?
Oh, a long time. So my first company was in 8th grade. Mm-hmm. We rented pictures from art class to everything that has a waiting room, like doctors and stuff like that.
Look at you, my goodness. So you're a natural born entrepreneur, if you will.
Well, yeah, I did 7 companies.
Yeah, oh, just 7, not many at all. So tell me, you did mention that you are a magician of sorts, and I was very intrigued by that. I mean, we speak to entrepreneurs every day, and they're obviously an interesting bunch, but a magician, tell me a little bit about this.
Yeah, that's my second world. Like, for 30 years, I'm doing magic. So my father is a magician, and when I told him I don't want to become a magician but a lawyer, he was going like, no!
So what do you do? Do you do this magician in your pastime? Do you involve it in your everyday work? How does it work?
Well, so now I'm trying to combine them both. Mm-hmm. So I'm starting as a career as a speaker. So
fantastic. I did see the speaker badge today. What are you speaking on today?
Not today, tomorrow.
Tomorrow. What is your session and what are you speaking about?
So I'm speaking together with Adam Shire, the inventor of Siri.
Yes.
And we are talking first on the academy stage about how startups can use psychology of magicians to create a better product or to convince people of their product.
Fantastic.
And we do the final show where we try to achieve that people wonder if they just saw a magic trick or a tech demo.
Oh, so, interesting. So tech and magic merge and they meet, huh?
Right.
I love
We demo a prototype of the neural lace, where Elon Musk also invested.
Okay, this sounds really, we have to film this and we'll be there to bring it to you guys. Yeah. This is awesome stuff. So, you know, how did you get into the whole speaker kind of world? You're very calm, by the way, you're very calm. You have very calm energy about you and I really like that. I'm very like on the go and high energy, so it's always good when there's someone that's leveled out a bit. So tell me, do you practice, like, because you are, your energy is really beautiful. Do you practice meditation? Are you into that sort of stuff? Or you just got the magician kind of calmness about you?
So I think with the magic comes, when you practice or do magic, you learn how to do that by yourself.
Right.
Like, because
you create your own magic.
So with magic, you need to guide people to a belief.
Yes.
So to sell the belief, and most people think that magic is all about misdirection. Okay, I do something here,
right,
and then
distraction,
look here, whatever. Mm-hmm. But it's more misdirection of the mind. Mm-hmm. I planned, like a little bit like Inception.
Right.
I planned an idea into your mind, mm-hmm, and then try to convince you that this is real.
Wow.
So. And to achieve that, you need to be grounded or to sound like you know what you're talking about, but in reality, it's just bullshit.
Absolutely.
And I think there are a lot of psychology aspects behind magic that you can use in startups as well. Like, for example, the main goal is to be bold.
Mm-hmm.
Often something happens you don't can account for.
Right.
Even in magic something goes wrong.
Yes.
But you need to get you keep your cool and just play along and own the situation.
Yes.
So that people think, okay, that was all planned and that's part of the trick.
Oh, I love it. Are you doing some magic right now in this interview? Are you planting any seeds in my mind?
Do you want to see a trick?
Yes, we want to see a trick. Hello, do we or what? We're ParlayMe people. We like to play all day.
Yay.
Okay, what's going on here? Yes.
So just take any card you
like. Any card, yes. And I can look at it?
Yes. And then you can sign it.
Oh, sign it. Which side?
Yeah,
the side,
front,
right?
Front,
okay.
Please.
Of course, right?
You can show the camera.
All right,
if you like.
I know. There's no mirrors behind me. It's all good. Okay, got it.
Okay.
Copy that.
Now,
yeah. I just said copy that, it's copy that, not in copy that.
Chase says, say stop anytime you like.
Stop.
Okay, put the card in.
Oh god.
It goes in between, yes?
Yes.
Now what we have to do is we take the top card, like this,
yes.
And can you touch it like this? And all we have to do is wave above it and it turns into your card.
Oh wow,
so
that's pretty amazing.
Now this time we don't just put it in, but we shuffle the cards. Yeah?
Yeah,
and not just the normal shuffle, but really mixing them up.
Mm-hmm.
Some cards face down, some cards face up. Mixing, yeah, face up, face down.
Wow.
Okay.
Wow. Don't
lose the cards. Put it there. So we have some cards face up,
yes.
Some face down.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Now we check if it's on top. No. And it's not on the bottom.
No.
So it must be somewhere.
Middle.
Yeah, but the problem is that the cards are mixed.
Uh-huh.
But if you snap your fingers once, snap, all the cards are face down again, except one card.
Oh wow, that's, yeah.
Now some people say if I shuffle the cards, I cheat.
Oh.
I do something with my hands and whatever.
Yeah.
But if you take the cards,
uh-huh.
And maybe...
Yes. Shuffle?
Shuffle, yeah.
Okay.
Great.
Okay. Shuffler, right?
Yeah, perfect.
Okay.
Thank you.
Alright.
Now, to prove to you that I don't cheat with my hands,
yes.
I don't use them. Oh.
What?
Oh.
Click.
Oh.
Oh my gosh! My golly gosh, people!
I think I got.
Wow, yeah, that's.
It's a little bit wet, but you can keep it.
That is amazing. Can I keep it for real? Actually, look guys, JB, it's right there. Seriously.
So, yeah.
And guys, there's nothing behind our backs. There's nothing. That was just real magic.
Thank you.
Thank you. So I have to ask one last question.
Yeah.
Are you a gambling, a poker, or a roulette man?
Poker.
Poker.
Because poker you can influence.
There is. There's lots of strategy.
Yeah, and you can read people and...
Poker face. Show us your poker face. Do you have one? You got. I think if you did that, people would know something's up. But that's all right. I think you'd win at a game of poker against me any day. So, look, it's such a pleasure to meet you,
yeah.
Till. I'm going to go. Guys, we're going to film this session tomorrow.
Yeah.
So I can't wait
the
to see
the big final
that.
Show.
Yeah, the big show. Oh, thank you so much. You're the
thank
best.
You.
Cheers. Hi, guys. We're here at Pioneers Festival, and we're here with Kian and also Christian from X-Tech. Hi, guys. You look very calm and collected today. What's going on?
Well, we just arrived this morning, and so we tried to get an overview of where everything is. It's a beautiful building. And,
I know.
But it's also very big, so
mm-hmm.
We found our way to the speaker's lounge. We've been looking on the top. So we're just settling in now.
Settling in, getting comfortable, and so are you, Sean. And what a beautiful location in Vienna. Now, where are you guys from exactly?
We're from Berlin, and our office is in close to the Hangische Markt. Exactly.
Oh,
yeah.
Fantastic. And is this your first time in Vienna? First time Pioneers Festival?
No, it's not our first time in Vienna.
Oh.
We actually decided to start the company in Vienna approximately like 2 years ago.
That's
true.
Really?
So,
really?
Yes.
Yeah. But we've never been at the Pioneers Festival.
Okay.
So we're very happy to be here.
Absolutely. And speaking here as well, so tell me a little bit about X-Tech, what you guys do and what you're speaking about today.
Yeah, so X-Tech is a blockchain-based payment platform for machines. So our daily work is for the Horizon 5. We think that autonomous cars, autonomous drones, all the sorts of IoT devices are need something like a transaction platform, close to paper but completely different because it's not for humans, it's just for machines.
Oh wow, so you're not a B2B or B2C, it's machine to machine?
Yes, yes of course, it's machine to machine economy.
Wow.
Yes.
This is fascinating.
A little bit nerdy, but really
hey,
cool.
Hey, we got, is it deep tech? deep tech?
It is.
Okay, cool. So how did you guys meet exactly?
Continue on that, just for a short minute. M2M is exactly right what you're saying, and right now in the medium run, it's M2M2C, because at the moment there's still someone that needs to be paid or that wants to be paid.
Right.
So you have the machines transacting with one another, and there's always an owner of the machine.
Yes.
So say you have a charging station or an electric vehicle, then the payout is the last mile, which we also facilitate.
Wow, this is really fascinating stuff. So you guys are numbers guys, are you scientists, are you data guys? How did you get into this?
Oh, this is funny, because we are both just product and biz heads, but we have a really strong tech team, which is lots of experience in banking and blockchain and also robotics technology. So this is a really interesting match.
Fantastic. Yeah. So you have built have you got proof of concept? Where are you at in your cycle of your startup?
So we're beyond proof of concept. We've got our the first use case right now is live in all of Germany, I think, right?
Oh, wow.
And we're working together with Energy, the Europe's largest energy company.
Fantastic. And, a good one.
That's the project is called Share and Charge, and that's live. It's been live for a couple of weeks now.
Awesome. So who are your potential clients? Like, they're obviously you're working with them, but who are the ones you really want to get in with and expand, either locally or globally?
So our main research for two kinds of clients. There's one kind which are providing something like a value. This is like an energy company.
Right.
And there's another kind of client, which is something like a startup, which want to develop a machine, maybe a delivery robot or an autonomous drone, which needs source of this technology.
Wow, so you guys are really, you're going to meet a lot of people obviously at this conference in this world. So tell me a little bit why you're here to speak. What are you speaking about? Are you pitching your business? Are you talking about, are you forecasting? Like, what are you here today to speak about?
Well, we are pitching together with Energy. So we are actually showcasing the different models that enable the machine-to-machine economy. Because what Energy has is a lighthouse for the machine economy.
Fantastic.
And they have a variety of use cases.
Yes.
And we are basically the backbone of the entire system, because we enable the payments for these. So in this context now, we are explaining how to further this machine economy.
So you're almost showing a case study, if you will, of what you're doing now and how this can work for other machine learning and whatnot.
Yeah, exactly. Yep. This is what we do. Perfect. This is the showcase what Kian explained a few weeks ago.
I love that. So tell me, how did you guys meet? I'm always fascinated how founders come together. Were you friends? Did you just meet at college one day? Did you work in your working life together? Like, how did you come about to meet?
Well, we've known each other for, I think, over 10 years now.
Oh, wow.
And, like, old childhood friends.
Nice.
And we both worked at different companies.
Yes.
2 years ago, and then we went on a trip to Vienna, actually.
Oh,
and we started discussing what we would actually like to do.
Yes.
So you had lots of different ideas.
You got inspired by this city? Did you get inspired by the city a little bit, right?
Maybe it was a reason for that.
Yes.
Because in Vienna, in 2 years ago, there was lots of healthy food, and there was also lots of kinds of payments, and we were thinking, Germany is a little bit slow, and we were thinking Germany is a step further than Austria, but yeah, maybe it is the reason too.
Right, I know. Well, look, guys, you're definitely in the right place. You're going to meet some fascinating people today.
Yeah.
To that point, are there any sessions? I know you don't get time at these places to actually see anything because you are networking the whole time. But are there any speakers or sessions you're particularly excited to maybe see while you are here, if you have time?
There's something new which is interesting. There's a speaker from the Singularity University.
I know, right? I know, guys. I wish I was there too. A lot to do and see. I thank you. Now, where can people actually find your company? Is there a URL? How can people find you on, like, Instagram, Twitter?
You can find us under xtech.ai.
Oh, there you go, .ai. Everyone's doing the .ai's, everyone. I love it. It's the new .com, guys. No, I love it. No, you guys are awesome. I'll put a link. You guys are the best. And I have one final question. It's very important for us here at ParlayMe. If you're a gambling man, not saying that you are, if you were.
If we were.
If you were, all hypothetical, are you a blackjack, a roulette, or a poker player? If you were.
I love poker, but I always wins on the roulette table.
Oh, right. So he likes the strategy, but you win by chance. I like that. And how about yourself?
I'd have to also opt for roulette. Roulette.
I like it too. A bit of fun, fast-paced
always
action.
Always black.
Interesting. I'm always red, you see, but hey, each of their own. Look, guys, such a pleasure to meet you guys. Get out there and enjoy the conference. And yeah, check them out online, guys. Go to their website. I mean, if you're interested, can they contact you guys? If people have some, you know, potential client out there, who should they get in contact with? You or you, both of you?
Anyone.
Anyone. Yeah. Anyone. The robot, the machine. No.
Just contact us at hello at xt.a.
Yeah.
Perfect. Easy. Well, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Cheers.
Thank
you. Hi guys, so as you know, we're here at Pioneers Festival and I am with Ryan Bethencourt, and you are from
IndieBio.
Yes, okay, yes. Thank you. That's not too hard to pronounce. No. So tell me, Ryan, what is IndieBio?
So IndieBio is the largest biotech accelerator in the world. Mm. We've built and funded nearly 70 biotech companies, about 68 biotech companies in 3 years.
Wow.
Many of the companies your listeners and watchers may have heard of.
Yes.
Memphis Meats, they grew the first lab-grown meatball. Beef, pork, they just recently came out with lab-grown chicken tender and duck l'orange. Should be on the market in 3 to 5 years. A bunch of other of our food companies, they're innovating on future food. We help fund companies in therapeutics, as well as some of our more unusual companies like Catalog Technologies, which stores digital data in DNA.
Oh wow, how fascinating. So are you a research scientist? What's your background?
I was once a geneticist, became a business guy,
and
developed therapeutics, clinical drugs.
Yes.
And then started IndieBio with my two other co-founders.
I love it. And where is IndieBio located?
San Francisco.
Oh, nice. Yes. Yeah, there's the accent. And is this your first Pioneers, second, third?
This is actually my third.
Oh,
Pioneers.
Wow. You're two ahead of me. This is my first. So tell me, what is it about this conference? There's so many in the world you can go to. What is it about this one you particularly love?
Yeah, so Pioneers truly is a global conference. Mm-hmm. That's something that's really appealed to me from the start. So I'm based in Silicon Valley in San Francisco, mm-hmm. where, you know, a lot of Silicon Valley tends to view the world of innovation as existing within the San Francisco Bay Area, which I think is a very limited worldview. At IndieBio, even though we're based in San Francisco, we serve the world, right? We serve all 7.4 billion of us.
Right.
And so I try and spend as much time outside of Silicon Valley as I can.
Good.
It's Pioneers is really the place I go to to get a global perspective, especially what's going on in Europe.
Right, absolutely. There's a lot of movement, a lot of going on. Everything's changing every day. So hi guys, we're here in Vienna and we are at Pioneers Festival. We are tuckled away, if you will, in a little corner. And I'm here with Philip Stengel. I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly. And we are here to talk everything investing. Yes, that's right. So Philip is running the venture capital division of Pioneer Ventures. Now tell me, Pioneer Ventures is based here in Vienna. This is why we're so desperate to talk to you guys, because you really are leading the charge, if you will, in pre-seeding, right? You invest, you do the pre-seed investment. Tell me a little bit about Pioneer Ventures.
So basically, we saw so many startups going through Pioneers.
Yes.
And it was kind of a pity that we couldn't really follow up with them in a structured way.
Right.
Because they were big success stories coming out of Pioneers. And we said, okay, we want to participate in the success stories.
Right.
And so besides the event series, we also do consulting in our Pioneers Discovery Unit. And 2 years ago, we decided to launch a Pioneers Ventures, which basically closes the circle. And now we're like a full stack provider for startups. And by providing investment, and of course the startups we invest in, we want to give them access to this whole network that comes out of the events and the consulting.
Absolutely. So when you say we decided a few years ago, who is that team, that core team?
So the founders of Pioneers, they started I think 7 years ago. And now Pioneers is a company of 40 people. We have a new CEO since a couple of months.
Wow.
And we have Pioneers Ventures with 4 people.
Oh, that's fantastic. So tell me, I know kind of your investment pool is around the 125K. Are there certain verticals you'd look in to invest in, or like what's the new kind of hot kind of startup you're looking to invest in?
So we are investing in startups that are around market entry, so shortly before, shortly after, and anything digital really.
Right.
And we are very much focused on technology.
Right.
So anything that really can scale with very little cost, because yes. We're in Europe, we have to be cost conscious, we don't have the same amount of capital as in Silicon Valley, for example.
Yes.
So we're looking for smart technology that can scale nicely.
I love it. And to that point, with scaling, it's so important the partnerships you make as a startup when you're starting, especially in your infancy, your pre-seed stage. One thing that's struck me about your company is that you really facilitate or help those introductions to partners, whether it's here or in the US. So can you tell us a little bit about how you bridge those partnerships?
Yeah, so this is exactly why we exist, right? So we don't run an accelerator program or something, but we strongly believe that the connections that come out of pioneers are of big value for early stage companies.
Right.
So for example, they wouldn't get in front of a big corporation when they're not even on the market, but we can make it happen.
Right.
Or also journalists like
yes,
you
yes.
and a lot of investors, follow-on investors,
yes.
that kind of trust the pioneers brand. And so if a part of the startup has investment from pioneers, that kind of shows okay they went through a due diligence that
yes.
made sense because we see so much cutting edge technology.
Yeah, absolutely. And this cutting technology everywhere. To that point, what are you excited about? Are you excited about deep tech? Are you excited about biotech? Are you know excited about all autonomous cars? Like what's driving you guys at the moment?
So there's a lot of really exciting technology here at Pioneer's events.
Yeah.
We have to focus on the digital niche.
Yes.
So even though we're personally excited about many industries, this digital.
Right.
Inside digital, I would say it's really still a lot about deep tech, so anything that's machine learning, blockchain, decentralized systems, algorithms, all of these things are super exciting.
Fantastic. And something else I really love about your company that I saw that you do a lot of kind of like white papers, if you will, or kind of insights into what's going on in Silicon Valley, you know, competitive analysis kind of stuff. Tell us a little bit about those sort of services you provide too.
So basically these are more services we provide to corporates.
Mm-hmm.
And so we basically help them how to work with startups. And that's
right.
not only consulting, but that really goes into the implementation stage.
Yes.
So we basically help them putting the innovation of the startups to work for both parties so that it's a beneficial relationship for both parties.
I love it. And tell me a bit about you. How did you get involved in all this? Are you an entrepreneur yourself? Are you an active investor? Like, how did you get involved in the whole startup ecosystem?
Yeah, so I was an entrepreneur myself.
Uh-huh.
I did an e-commerce company for 3 years. We had VC backing ourselves, so I kind of know the roller coaster a little bit.
Yes.
And then when we sold the company to a competitor, I kind of changed the size of the table. But so now I feel like I can relate to the founders and their problems and their
yes.
you know, understanding when something doesn't go like it was planned, right?
Absolutely. Never goes quite to plan. So tell me, do you guys take kind of like a board position, or what kind of position do you take within the companies once you invest?
So usually not a formal board position because companies are too early stage for that.
Yes.
But definitely we meet regularly and have a very personal relationship, and basically our startups can call us 24/7 and try to be there as much as possible.
Fantastic. And you have a relationship with SpeedInvest too. Tell us a little bit about that, because I know they refer a lot of startups to you if they aren't quite at the product stage that they need them at. Tell us about that relationship.
Exactly. So we work very closely with them. They refer startups to us, just to Ali and the other way around.
Yes.
And of course, I think four of our startups already got follow-on investments from Speed Invest, but we work with many seed investors.
Yes.
So, of course, you know, at this festival, we have over many hundreds of investors.
Right.
We try to work with all of them.
Yes.
But Speed Invest happens to be in Vienna as well, so we have a very friendly relationship.
Fantastic. Fantastic. Well, you guys are doing astonishingly well. I know everywhere I've gone through this festival, of course, pioneers, pioneers, pioneers. And then, you know, you're here, so it's fabulous. And I thank you for spending the time with us. We do have two questions we always ask at ParlayMe. One's a little more important than the other. But if there's an entrepreneur, or you can, in your case, you can say an investor, perhaps, that inspires you or really kind of sets a pinnacle for how to do business or, you know, the dream, who is that person? And you can name someone in your personal life. It doesn't have to be someone we all know.
Well, it's very easy. It's Elon Musk, for sure.
Yes.
I love one thing he said. Companies create value by doing difficult things. And this is kind of what I preach in my startup as well, and what I try to also do myself.
Right.
Try to do deep work and do difficult things, because that's the only way you create value.
Absolutely. Hard work prevails, people. And our final question, are you a blackjack, a roulette, or a poker player? If you were to be a gambling man, not endorsing, but if you were.
So I'm not.
Okay.
But if I were, probably blackjack.
Blackjack.
Because you have to calculate.
I know. You definitely have to calculate a little with that. Well, look, thank you so much for your time. Enjoy this festival. Are there any speakers? I know you don't get time at these things to really walk around, but are there any speakers you're particularly interested in hearing from today?
So what I would probably recommend is listening to Andrew Chen.
Yes.
I was lucky enough to go on a dinner with him with seven of our portfolio companies on our Silicon Valley trip.
Okay.
It was really inspiring talking to him, and he was giving a very personal tip to everybody.
Yes.
And I can only recommend watching his session.
He's a great guy. Well, thank you. We'll be sure to check out his session. Thank you for your time, and enjoy the festival.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Cheers. Hi, guys. We're here at Pioneers Festival, and we are in the Media Lounge, and we are here with Gabriel Tatzberger. Am I pronouncing that correct?
Yes.
Okay, good. Excellent. And you are from the Vienna Business Agency. Tell us a little bit about what you guys do here in Vienna.
So we try to support the Viennese startup ecosystem and the economy here in Vienna.
Yes.
We have grants we're giving to companies that come here or stay here, so 40 million every year.
Fantastic.
We have a real estate department where we offer real estate for big companies to startups, everything.
Wow.
And we have services where we invite, for example, international startups to come here for 2 months.
Yes.
So if there's anybody interested in that, just apply for it.
Fantastic.
And we pay travel costs, living, co-working, networking, and everything, and, you know, give them the opportunity to see if there is an option for them here.
Yes. So you are vital to the Vienna startup ecosystem, let's say.
Yeah.
So tell me, you're obviously government founded.
Yes.
How did this come about? When did you guys realize, okay, we need to really invest in this and create this a really viable business platform for Vienna?
So it started with a quite small bunch of people.
Mm-hmm.
I was involved with them very much, and we saw a real opportunity to make something big.
Yes.
And the real activities, I would say, started 2008.
Uh-huh.
And since then, the ecosystem, the scene is really exploding and developing very dynamically.
Yes.
So the number of co-working spaces, accelerators, also funds, really increasing, and it's amazing to see.
It is amazing to see. I saw some stat the other day where it was like 2.6 billion was invested in Europe in the tech startup space. In 2016, that was 13 billion.
Yeah.
So there is so more capital available than ever before.
Yeah.
With that in mind, how are agencies like yourself kind of dealing with that, kind of like, how do we reposition ourselves, how do we attract, because it's a more competitive market,
The
right talent?
The thing is that we have some USPs here in Vienna. If somebody is interested in the Central Eastern European market, We are a very international city. Half of the people living here are migrants.
Right.
Half of the startups that are here don't have Austrian citizenships. And we have many people out of this region, and so we have the competence, the culture, the language. So it's a quite good starting point to go into these markets.
It's absolutely, yes, I can.
And there are some branches where we are really leaders, like in life science and biotechnology. biotechnology.
Yes.
We're a very strong community. We're one of the hotspots of the chatbot community. So we have the first chatbot accelerator here in Vienna.
Yes.
So it's quite, there are some, you know,
we
niches.
Spoke to them yesterday.
Oh,
we went, yes,
great.
We went
yeah.
there yesterday and they gave a full presentation.
Yeah.
We met Jacob,
yeah,
the founder.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, it was
yeah,
awesome.
Yeah.
Awesome.
And in VR and AI, we have quite a strong community and we really try as an agency to support this new bottom-up development and support them also with international activities and so on.
I love that. And to that point, with deep tech specifically, I feel there's a lot of deep tech companies coming out of Vienna.
Sure.
What other industries or verticals, if you will, are really flourishing here in Vienna? Or is it kind of agnostic? Like, how does it work?
You mean in deep tech now?
Yeah, like, are there certain verticals that, or startups that are doing really well in Vienna that, that you're attracting? I feel there's a lot of deep tech ones.
Yeah.
You tell me,
We have, for example, a very world market leader in 3D printing with specific ceramics.
Oh.
You can also use to implement in the body.
Oh.
So it's really, it's here we are in deep cooperation also with the University of Technology.
Yes.
And we try really to bring these kind of people out and to help them in order to make their startup and make their business here.
Fantastic. And then how do you go about attracting that talent on global scale? Like, other than attending events like this, are there other festivals around the world you have a presence at? How do you go about that?
So different ways. To be honest, we have someone who is scouting for us.
Mm-hmm.
We go to South by Southwest, DLT, etc. And, you know, just bring out the message that we have something to offer.
Yes.
And the resonance is very huge, especially now also from the US. We have quite many people asking us how we can come here, how
we can
look.
And why not? It's such a beautiful spot, right? I mean, if you're going to have a startup, this is a beautiful place to have it as well.
Yeah.
To that note, what does Vienna offer that other cities don't in regards to lifestyle, balance, work, all that sort of stuff?
So we are the city with the highest quality of living since 8 years, according to Mercer.
Okay,
so
stop right there. I mean, that's right, the stats.
Do I have to say
it? I know, that's it, that's it. You just said it. And if you take a stroll around Vienna, it is exceptional. I mean, this conference is here at the Hofburg Imperial Palace, and it is stunning.
Yeah.
I mean, to have a festival of this caliber in a place like this, it's truly magnificent. So tell me, you're a very busy woman, so I don't want to keep you too much longer. What would you say to any startups that are watching this today and thinking, oh, why Vienna? Like, what should they do to get on your radar? Or what should they do to, you know, become involved in your ecosystem?
Yeah. Just get in contact with us.
Yep.
We are really happy if you can help.
Yeah.
We know the network here in Austria, but also we also have an international network.
Mm.
Just ask or just tell us what you're doing and we can tell you if you can help or not.
Oh, I love it.
Yeah.
See, guys, it's that simple.
Thank
just
you.
Ask and you shall receive.
Yeah.
Look, thank you so much, Gabriel.
Thank you.
It's such a pleasure. We do have two final questions, actually. We never not ask this question. So one's a little more important than the other. If there was an entrepreneur or an investor or a startup or someone in your personal life even that you really aspire to or really influences you as like the ultimate kind of entrepreneur, if you will, who would that be?
Elon Musk.
Elon Musk. Yes.
Yes.
Right? I know. Exceptional. What can the guy can't go wrong.
Yeah.
I totally hear. And our last but final question, if you're a gambling person, not that you are, are you a blackjack, a roulette or a poker player?
Poker.
I like it.
Yes.
There you go. I love that. We always have to ask that here at ParlayMe. Thank you so much.
Thank
Such
you.
A pleasure to meet you and enjoy the conference.
You too.
I will.
Okay.
I will. Thank you.
You.